Hello, everyone, and welcome back to our third qualifier in Nay Split 2. I'm here with...
Sensation.
And my name is Zone. Right now, we are currently just waiting for everyone to get in lobbies and codes to be sent out. For right now, we're just going to discuss a little things that have been added into since yesterday, which is like the new four mythics. One still being in the game already with the Chorus Water Mythic. You have anything else to add with the...
Then we got the new firebending, earthbending, and airbending mythics that have really changed the game so far.
Yes, with the air being a lot of movement for the new... since we only have like three movement items at the moment.
Yeah, and the earthbending with some protection, making that earth wall.
Yeah, I mean, the earth wall kind of feels like the old ice wall that was added in the game. I mean, the only thing different with the new ice, the earth wall... though, is that when you make a new one, it destroys the last one quickly.
Yeah, there's only one. I've also noticed that the earth bending, when you make the wall and the fire bending, that can save you from fall damage now, as well as the air bending naturally because of the movement speed on it.
That is true. I do know. I would love to see like the our two teams that are playing today, the black and white, see if they actually add these mythics into their rotation of like loot pool. I know it's brand new, so most teams probably won't actually like use them as much. But I mean, it'd be kind of cool to see like the earth wall being used today in the qualifier.
Yeah, it'll be pretty nice to see how they effectively use those in the matches and how they interpret them into their loadouts.
Other things that we've noticed is this is the last qualifier for Nay, so. There is another way to qual if you don't get in the top four today, and that is by having points over the three qualifiers and being in like the top 24 of those. But hopefully we can get our last two fairest teams to qual today, because that would be really cool to see. I know that Crimson and Gold are already done, so we might not see them play as much. I know Gold has a solo today. So if they do something or they get extra points, it would be cool. A little extra into their point category that they already have.
Yeah. I mean, it's your final chance to get there, so we got to do something to get, like, up there in the leaderboards.
Yeah.
Qualify for that championship next.
This is their last chance. The finals will be next weekend. And, I mean, it would, like I said again, it would be really good to see all four teams of Ferris to be in there and representing. I mean, I know there's no prize pool for this one. But the practice for next semester and having the same teammates for next semester will always be a good thing.
Yeah. As you can see, we're showing some of our players up on the screen now.
As we have right here, this is Llama. We have Andy. These are Team White. Our other two players, Droids and Dark, they will be Team Black. This is Dark.
Getting mentally prepared for the match.
Oh, yeah. I know one of the teams, they ran into a little rank before the game, so hopefully that'll help them warm up before this amazing qualifier.
Yeah, we should see some really special plays here in this qualifier from talking to the teams before.
As I do know, the codes have been sent out. There's usually a little time for the first one. There's like usually 10 minutes, maybe less. It depends on how many people will get into the server fast enough. There has been a lot of issues over time with the codes. So hopefully we get both of our teams in there so that there's no issues.
Yeah.
Anything else that you have seen that added or will change the rotation of like how people will play?
Just the same medallions that have been in the game for so long. Those medallions, like the Siphon, the
Dash Vanilla from the Cerberus himself.
Yep, the Cerberus.
You have Zeus, and he has your speed and like height increased, yep. Basically.
And then don't forget about Brawlers, that mythic AR, and that extra damage output from that.
With long range. Probably the best drop, in my opinion, for a Zero build at least, is having that the AR, which is no recoil. Extra damage at range really helps when you're sitting and placing everyone on bunkers. Like end game, I know as me and Sen have played multiple qualifiers, we usually splay bunkers walls as much as we can so that people can't just hide.
Exactly. But when those start to run out, you can really get in a tight situation sometimes.
That's where I think having those shield bubbles extra, you know. I know a lot of teams do like to have their second player have shield bubbles. On top of that, I mean, they did have the bunkers this season too. So there is goat inside of those bunkers, and you know, getting those attachments on the guns just so that you feel better when you're shooting. They are hard in zero build to contest because you only have bunkers to protect yourself. Hopefully you don't get jumped on by three different teams, because that's the only issue when you get stuck down in one of those.
Yeah, I mean, going back to that Earth Mythic, you know, that's a 10-second cooldown on that. Like, that would be a really helpful end game, just putting one of those up to protect yourself for a minute.
Yeah, I mean, having the Earth over the probably a shield, always making sure you still have bunkers, because, I mean, you still have to need to cover your back in case you are not riding this storm and you're sitting in the middle.
Yeah.
So having that Earth Mythic when you have no bunkers left and you're rotating on, like, a dead side of the zone, you pretty much are protected from your front side. Your back side, you're hopefully the storm is behind you and no one's playing inside of the storm.
Yeah. Also, that airbending, it makes you kind of vulnerable, doesn't it?
Just rotating. Airbending does. It gives you, like, this weird animation when you're going around, like, turning and stuff. And when you stop, you can dash in the air and try to maneuver yourself in that situation. And on top of that, you could just jump onto someone and from height, and then like switch to your gun, and you won't take any fall damage. So it's a very aggro player like movement for someone if they want to key the whole lobby.
Yeah. As we see our players waiting in queue up on stage.
And we have our coach Zaz in the front talking to all the players and making sure they're ready. The lobby should start here soon, probably in 3-4 minutes. There's not really too much at the moment. Just making sure everyone has a good mind where they're gonna land, rotate, making sure they're playing passive to the end game. I feel like that's one of the biggest keys to like a zero build. Not always playing so aggressive. Maybe getting one or two picks early so that you have the ammo, because that's one of the biggest issues is running out of ammo in zero build when you're spraying down someone's bunker.
Yes, absolutely. That ammo can become very scarce really fast. But that new waterbending mythic, you don't need ammo for that. It's infinite. You can just keep on reloading it.
It's like not even a 2-second like reload. Probably even faster than that, to be honest.
Yeah.
And it does like 25 damage. And then at the end, it hits for a 25. And the range, there is drop-off on the range, which is, it helps, but it's still a really broken item that Epic did add into the game.
Yeah, those headshot damage also is 36. That's a huge 36. Headshot increase, yes.
Oh, see, I didn't even know that. And I play too much of the game, I would say.
But sometimes that water reload, that animation will, like, give opponents an extra time to react. And you could possibly...
Yeah, one of the biggest flaws is that if you are missing because of that delay, there's people that are going to just spray at you. And a lot of teams, when they start hearing it, they can hear it without even seeing like a sound effect to it, and they just start spraying at you because of that how loud it is. I mean, considering as me and Sen have been playing multiple like quals together, we've like the new Zeus mythic with a bull when you get stuck in the air is probably the worst item to carry in zero build. Definitely if you don't have a sniper or someone watching for you, because all you're stuck in the animation unless you have dashes to be able to dash between in the air. It's the only way to counter yourself from being just stuck in one place. And there not many people when you're like sitting in like the Zeus like Mount Olympus, you don't have any of those dash effects.
Yeah. Let's talk about some of that movement in the game still, like the Flowberry Fizz and the Impulses.
We do have Flowberry Fizz. We have the Flowberries. We do Impulses. And we do have Wings. Wings are they're still in the game. They're not the best, not the greatest. I recommend, like most teams and our teams today, to probably using the Flowberry Fizz as one of the biggest rotational things. You only need one per person, maybe two if you don't know how to use it properly. But having like impulses in that Flowberry Fizz when you're on the opposite side of a zone and you need to rotate from like a long distance without getting sprayed down, I recommend those are like one of the best mobility items that they have in the game still. Other things like the wings, you can use the wings. I mean, I would use them more of as like if you're not trying to take fall damage from like if you're playing height off of like buildings. I recommend that. But flying, they increase the hitbox on the wings. The wings act more like another player attached to you.
Yeah. Also, that Fluoberry Fizz on launch pads will just launch you higher than ever, really. And you get halfway across the map just from that. So that Fluoberry Fizz is definitely one of the key movement items in that game.
And here we are. We are in game. We have Llama and Andy. We are currently landing away from Grand Glacier. Oh, no. We're rotating still into Grand Glacier. Looks like no one is contesting this POI, so this should be a good drop for the Team White to get all like a good loot pool before they actually push.
Good loot pool. It looks like he's getting some earthbending mythics right there already to start the game off.
Yeah, and these are what we were just talking about. These mythic scrolls, they're from Avatar, if you've ever watched it. This one is the Earth. This one gives you the wall that we were talking about. This is probably one of the best mythics they have in the game besides the air one as of right now.
Andy's starting off with a blue auto shotgun. That'll probably help him later on with that massive amount of ammo in it. There's that Earth wall we were talking about earlier. Play off that pretty well.
As of right now, they're just making sure we get this like ammo, guns, meds. This is the Flowberry. The Flowberry Fizz they're probably going to carry. This is Team Black as well, and they have landed in Reckless. It's not a horrible POI. It's not the best. All I know is that there's a lot of shield kegs in this area, so they would make sure that they have max shield before they even rotate out of this area. As I know as well, is Dark it loves his sniper, so you'll always see a sniper in his inventory if he can find one.
I also see him carrying Dark carrying shield bubbles, and I see droids carrying some bunkers with him, as well as those clingers, which can put some damage out on people.
Yep, the clingers, they do 30 per... like every single time another cluster comes out, it's 30 damage to a player, and definitely when you're in a fight and like and they're just playing bunkers, those clusters do come in handy.
Yep. Now the droids got some more Flowberry Fizz on them.
And I'm assuming that they are right now. They have spotted a team on the opposite side of the POI, so they're trying to play passive and make sure that they know where they are before the enemy team can actually realize what they're doing.
Yes. Droid's dropping some bunkers down. It looks like for Dart.
Yeah, as we were stating, usually most duos they run bunkers and shield bubbles separate. So one person will run the shield bubble. The other player will run the bunker. So they're currently just making sure that they split all the loot between each other so that in the end game, they know what they're doing in that situation.
I see on the map they did mark where an air mythic is. So they're probably going to try to get to that for rotation. They see a team across the train station.
74. This team, they're not looking the best. Our team, pretty good team, pretty passive team, I would say. They're not going to play too aggro. They don't know where the second player is, but they did get a good, decent tag on the team.
Looks like Droids is playing off the bush, and Dark's trying to flank from the right side.
As we see, Dark might start getting closer to try to see if he could find the other player to see if they can get some tags off of each other with a crossfire. In this situation, I would say trying to get to high ground before making a play is always your best bet, just since it's harder to shoot up than when you're looking down at someone.
Yes, very much so. A height differential could be a crucial part to a team's gameplay. So we'll see how they play it now. Still looking for those people inside Reckless Railways.
Yeah, considering in this situation, they don't have much. They have Flowberry Fizz, which is only 60. That's all their shield on Dark at the moment. And as I remember, Droids, he only had a Flowberry Fizz as well. So they're just trying to play safe as much as they can. They're trying to get over to this mythic era so they have mobility before endgame. I mean, they could try to push this team just so they can try to get a refresh, but it won't be the best. Switching back over to Team White with Llama and Andy, they pushed down to the Zenith Wall. If you don't know, this area of the by Grand Glacier is called Zenith Wall. It's a POI that me and Sen have played most of our games in.
Yep. It looks like they both have airbending now. Llama finding another one for Andy. And they still are carrying those earth walls for that extra protection. So we'll see how they play with them later in the game. But Llama does have that purple auto shotgun I just saw, and that'll also play pretty crucial. They're both running autos, and it's going to play really crucial towards endgame when the opponents are so close together with all that ammo in it.
Yeah, I mean, having two autos, definitely in zero build, it's more of a, you don't want to switch guns when you start a fight. Considering right now we're on Team Black, they have found the team. They're on top of Grand Station at the moment, fighting. The other opponent had Shield Bumble, so they're probably going to just play back, try to figure out how to get a different angle on this team.
That Shield Bubble doesn't have long. It's probably going to go away in a second. I'm pretty sure Dark's going to take advantage of that.
Yep, with a 116 tag and a good 35 spray on him and a push, and they eliminate Unmasked Rabbit with a good, you know, refresh, definitely trying to get these air mythics that they've been working for.
Yes, very, very much so. That snipe was really crucial, too. Like, we need to get some damage on him before you push him. Otherwise, you're just in basically a standstill until somebody does more damage.
You are taking a 50-50 if you try to push him without actually cracking their shield. I mean, you do get that extra 50 over shield in zero build, which is crucial to try to break that so that if you are pushing a team, you have the leverage over the other team.
Yes, yes, very much so. And it looks like they're just going to loot up some more, loot up Grand Station some more. Here comes the train. They might actually jump on train and try to take it.
Yeah, with the train being added in this chapter, there is like four chests technically on this, and you get it's like a capture point. You can capture this big chest to Dark's right, and then you get extra like shield meds and all that to... Definitely looking very scarce right now. I mean, Dark finally using his chug splashes to max out his health.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure earlier they did hear some people over at that observation tower, which also just shows you where the next storm circle is going to be, which could also be kind of just crucial to like endgame because you know where to go. You know where to put your bunker. You know all this extra information that other teams don't.
All right, back over to Team White. We are currently in a bush, just playing to the end game. This is what I was saying. In Zero Boat, it's not really a push everyone. Definitely when you're trying to qual, you really want to get those placements, which placements don't start until like top 17. So they're just going to play passive as much as they can. And then if they see a team, they might try to fight them.
Yes, and that airbending on water makes you go so much faster to travel across lakes and just across the map to... get to where you need to be, or if you're in a sticky situation, or if you just need to rotate zone.
Oh yeah, showing these airbending mythics as well. I mean, you can sprint an animation to increase your speed. You can double dash, and if you're trying to like fight someone from height, you can jump off with it and then pull out your gun, and you will take zero fall damage.
Yeah, fall damage is also another. Crucial thing that happens in zero build. You gotta make sure you're aware of your surroundings. Like if you're near a mountain or if you get knocked down, like you can't be taking that extra damage because that could just be like the end game for you already.
Yeah, pretty much. If you take too much like fall damage, definitely an end game. You're pretty much gonna have to ride the storm and hope you have greens to heal yourself. As like we see right now, Llama does have two med kits in his inventory. They're currently going up onto Mount Olympus just to get a better angle over their opponents and see what people are doing. They might try to see if Mount Olympus has Zeus still in the area and to see if they can actually take this medallion.
Yeah, looking for those two mythics. It can change. Trying to get up the statue, that could be a game changer, getting all that extra height. But just staying up on this mountain could, just for like a little bit, you know, could just be perfect for them if someone tries to push up to them.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the only ways to get up there currently right now, you can launch pad up, or you could just, like, run straight up, which will put you in a situation where you have nowhere to, like, throw a bunker and be protected as much.
You're putting the earthbending down to cover themselves in so they don't get damaged by an upcoming team. It's a perfect play by them.
Yeah, so I can see right now they're just trying to use the mythic to get on top of Zeus himself. Maybe just to see if they can get a better light of sight onto the enemy, which I wouldn't say is the best play, but I mean, if it works for them, then let them do it, right?
Exactly.
back over to Team Black, dropping the sniper to pick up the water mythic that we were talking about. This water mythic is really good. Definitely if you're into like a close range fight.
Yes, it basically shoots ice shards in a burst pattern. So, and with the infinite ammo, that could... they spotted a team down right beneath them.
Team? Yep, currently, they using this water mythic that I was saying, it hits fast, hits hard, but we know Team Black, they know what to do. They're just going to like heal up, make sure they play smart. They do have the advantage. If the team does push into them off of this, it will be a close corner fight, and they do have the auto shotguns to help them.
I think on the screen there, we see the visual sound effects giving the airbending away that the other team is using, probably trying to get to a better position or to run away, possibly.
It does look like they were trying to disengage in this fight right now. As right now, Team Black is just going to stay up here. They're just going to hold off. They're right now playing on the edge of the storm, so they definitely know when they start rotating into the next circle that there should not be a player behind them. It gives them a much easier advantage to rotate into the circle without actually taking damage from anyone else.
Yeah, they're just trying to camp out those placement points. Those placement points get pretty heavy towards the end game, starting at 17th place with 1 point and going all the way up to first with 25.
Yeah, that's the one difference between Nace and like an actual Fortnite tournament. Our placement points are very slim, but they do like start hitting heavy when you get into that top like 10 situation. So just trying to get up there, get some placements before you even take a fight. As we see, and the Llama are in a fight currently against another team that has rode up. Llama being at the bottom of the mountain.
Yeah, they're separated. They could run into some trouble here if they're not smart about it. I think previously we saw Andy trying to disengage with Llama. Yep, and they're trying to rotate away from that team to just get those placement points.
Just make sure they're together. I mean, they were split in that situation. This team does look like in visual sound effects, they are trying to push them.
As they are engaged in a battle right now. And the other team does have high ground, and Llama just got knocked from... What was that?
Llama has been knocked by one of the duos right now. He has been eliminated. Right now, Andy is in a fight. And I mean, that's one of the difference between that auto shotgun. It really doesn't hit as much no more.
Yep.
Back to Team Black. Still sitting in Reckless, just knowing that Storm is on their backside. They didn't know there was a team still in this area. I mean, they did use the Air Mythic not that long ago.
Yeah. And so they're just holding their ground. They have height at Reckless Railways right now. So as long as they just hold there, if anyone pushes them, they have low ground. They could get some easy damage off them and possibly even some kills.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the loot, they look good on loot right now. I mean, they do have a gold AR with a purple sniper for droids. And right now, Dark is sitting with an auto and a sniper. Really good mobility. And they do have the shield bubble in that the bunkers, as I was explaining earlier. So these guys could play it out until endgame before they want to take an initial fight with a team.
Yeah, very interesting playing without a type of spray weapon for Dark. It could, I mean, the sniper does great damage at far range, and then the auto does great damage at close range, but that medium range, he could run into some trouble without a spray weapon.
Yeah, it could be a real big issue for them if they get into an engagement anywhere between like two bunkers.
Or if that auto shotgun runs out of ammo at close range, he only has a sniper for backup. That auto shotgun has a long reload time. It could take a minute for him to reload that shotgun.
Oh, yeah, as we see right now, we're just currently just sitting, just waiting for a storm to close. We're going to try to figure out what this next circle pull is. They did see a team rotate north in a vehicle. As of right now, they know where two teams were in the situation. Maybe that would be some acknowledgement. If they do need to get a refresher or anything at the end, they could push those teams from behind.
Yes. It looks like they're... there is a medallion somewhere in the center of the circle. I just saw it on Dark's minimap. So we'll see how they play against them. And it looks like some air bending players are rolling in. They're going to try. Our team is probably going to try to get a jump on them if they can. The other team does not know we're here.
This might be an engagement they might want to take if they can get a pick on one of the players before they push, or at least to get a good damage with these two snipers. Because this team does not know that Dark and droids are up. With 116, with 157, They're going to take this fight now. Droids from behind, pushing. 83, 28, knock. They're gonna, they know where the last guy is from behind. Yeah. Droids just making sure he gets to third so that the team cannot revive in this situation. That is a good play from both the Team Black right now.
Now they just got to disengage for that fight a little bit to heal up so they don't accidentally get knocked or anything like that. The other person did disengage pretty fast from them heading towards Grand Station. And they are hearing some shots to their northwest, so they're going to jump in this bush and try to check it out.
Yeah, now we do see that Dark has very low HP, and they do got to move to the circle soon, knowing that there was a team like 200 meters out just playing over there, so they're probably going to rotate to this left side just so they know they can get away from someone and try to find some extra greens.
Yes, that new to the season Gatekeeper shotgun that Droids is carrying actually hits some pretty good damage. Has a faster reload than the auto, but with that speed mat, it makes it even faster. So you could do some pretty good damage with that Gatekeeper.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it has a really good medium damage range, too. I mean, you could do a good 60 tag if you do hit someone in the head from like 20 meters out. Right now, you see he's using apples to get the HP up. Maybe they might go check inside a Grand to see if they can find any med kits or bandages before they try to rotate in. They're going to play this edge still so that they know that no one's behind them. But you do see right now on their visuals is a car going through Grand Station and rotating out.
Yeah, Dark still has 6 minis and 100 Flowberry Fizz. They save him for the end game. They do hear some shots popping off north of them, straight north. And they're just trying to play it passive until Dark can get his HP up.
And there's the bandages. He did find them, which is really, really good for this team. They might try to make another play. They do have 2 kills, though. They did get the second elim, and the guy must have rotated back into Storm to try to get his teammates a reboot card, which did not work out for him. Knowing that they have teams north and they're riding a Storm, they're probably just going to play off the Storm. But if you do see at the minimap right now, that the Storm pulls very far northwest. So they're going to have to try to rotate to all these teams that have been playing right next to them this whole time.
Yeah, the Storm is north. They got to make a rotate pretty soon here. Otherwise, they could run into some problems with some people storm-holding them.
That is true. I with these Shieldbowers, with a 116, they have found a team. They initiate a fight with a good Shieldbower from Dark here. They're going to just try to play smart. As the cluster grenades have been tossed out, they do know that one's weak, so they might just try to focus the guy on the left the most.
Dark's got to be careful. That Shieldbower is about to collapse.
And they're not a very aggressive team here. They're just playing smart, passive. This is the gameplay you love to see. With a bunker down, they do have 6 seconds to rotate, so they might have to take this fight very fast.
Yes, and their only movement, it looks like, is Flowberry Fizz. So it'll be pretty hard. Oh, they do have impulses, and Dark got caught right in the house with the enemy team.
Both in the house together. They're going to have to take this fight in the Storm and just hope they can win.
Dark goes down. Droids with a picks double up elimination. Double kills.
But they do not have any greens.
More people in Storm. Droids is trying to hold out.
Droids might just have to disengage and leave Dark behind and come back for his reboot later.
Yes. I mean, Droids has to be careful. He does not have any white meds, and it is a 2-tick about to turn into a 5-tick. So we are going to see how he plays this and if he either has to run or he has to engage the fight and hope they have whites.
Yeah, seeing that they...
Ferris's most popular school is the School of Business, boasting a wide variety of programs in business and management fields. Established nearly a century ago, Ferris's School of Pharmacy remains one of the most prestigious pharmacy schools in the Midwest. More than half of all practicing pharmacists in Michigan hail from Ferris. The newest addition to Ferris is the College of Optometry, the only such school in Michigan and one of 14 in the nation. Ferris's place at the forefront of technical education is maintained by the Schools of Education and Technology. Career-oriented hands-on training in all of Ferris's programs produce an overall job placement rate of over 90%. This combined with student dedication has made success a tradition at Ferris for over 100 years. The 1984 centennial celebration saw the arrival of a new Ferris State College president, J. William Winrick. His plan is to renew the commitment to practical education at Woodbridge in Ferris, made over a century ago.
Ferris will maintain its distinctive mission of training people for careers, for professions, occupations, that it does so well. And the difference will be primarily in these new occupations, new technologies. As society and technology changes, we're going to change to respond to that. The basic mission won't change at all.
Another new face is head football coach Dan Underwood. He comes fresh from shining successes as defensive assistant for Central Michigan, Michigan State, and most recently, Arizona State, where he helped coach the defensive team to the number one spot in the nation.
Really, Dan Underwood is a superb coach. He's a great guy, great human being. He's starting new first year as I am at the college. He's bringing in his own system, his own people, his own assistants. He's educating and training players in the way he wants them to do. This year we've had a heavily freshman team, got kids who are coming in for the first time with Dan. And I'm really excited about what he's doing and can do.
Dan Underwood's goal for the Bulldogs is to be the best Division II team in the country. This may take some time, but he's very optimistic.
We're a very, very young program, and we're excited about the future. And we look for very, very good things to happen here.
Freshmen are vital to the football team and should expect to see some action on the field their first year at Ferris.
A young man, if he's interested in coming in and playing early, he can do that at Ferris State. And we're looking, we had 54 freshmen this last fall. And we had at one time as many as 14 start for us. So I think next year and the years to come, you're going to see freshmen and sophomores as we grow up play. So I think it's a great opportunity for a freshman to come in and play early.
Coaching staff here at Ferris is great. We had a good coaching staff the last 3 years I've been here, but for my senior year, we had a new staff come in. Dan Underwood came in from Arizona State and brought along an excellent staff with him. I think the next 3 years, the team will improve a lot, and it's a young team, and they brought in 45 recruits, and between those guys, I think they're gonna have a real football dynasty in the next 3 years.
I think the programs are fine also. It's a variety of programs that you can go into. They have something for everyone.
I think the coaching staff is great. All the new coaches came in, brought a lot of freshmen in, and let everybody see what they can do, and told all the players that all the jobs was open.
I like most about Ferris is that you're an individual up here and people understand you, they know you, and you're not treated like just another number like you would be at another school possibility. And it's just, you're treated as one, an individual.
I really like the coaching staff. They're really nice. They're young coaching staff, and I think they'll take us to the championship.
What I like most about Ferris is the campus life. There's a lot of activities on campus here at Ferris. You meet a lot of interesting people, and there's just a lot of things to do for you.
Our coaching staff is very enthusiastic, very excited. Always keep you pumped up and ready for the game. You can be doing season and off season.
To help build the special skills required to create a winning team, Dan Underwood brought in his own coaching assistants. Underwood believes that you win on defense. He also knows that you can't win without a good blend of running and throwing. And you can't forget the fan support. Football is an important part of Ferris State College. Athletes learn about teamwork, personal commitment, and they all reach for that common goal, success. Industry, opportunity, education. The ideas upon which Woodbridge and Ferris founded the institution, and 100 years later, are still the driving force behind Ferris's success, not only in the classroom, but out on the field. Ferris State College, an attitude of success that started in the mind of one great man, Woodbridge N. Ferris. A former governor of Michigan and United States Senator, Ferris founded the institution 100 years ago. His intent was to provide a practical education for any person with the motivation and potential to benefit. Initially known as
welcome back to it was game two. It was very unfortunate what happened to both of our teams in the game one. Hopefully we could see a little difference and a pickup on game two.
Yes. I was just speaking with our no-build gold team, and he's playing solo today. But he said he landed Grim Gate, and no one landed there with him.
So. I mean, an uncontested POI that has a mythic in mobility. So, I mean, you might see one of the team white go there just to see if they can contest it.
Yeah, they might. Getting one of those medallions, any really one of them, is a game changer, really.
It is an advantage. I mean, the most powerful one, in my opinion, would be like the Cyberish Dash. Gives you mobility the whole game. On top of that, so we might see Team Black or White want to go for that because mobility was one of the biggest things they did have, as Team Black did die in Storm Game 1. Unfortunate, there's two teams still in Storm on a long rotational Storm that pulled Northwest.
Very unfortunate for them, yes. No Whites, just trying to get out of there, and they just couldn't make it. Multiple teams on them still in Storm. Multiple teams died to Storm later on as well. And they're just trying to survive, really.
Yeah, they were just trying to get those placements. I mean, they did get 7 points that last game. So, I mean, that's always a good start. It does add to the total of all three games. So they could qual off just getting the points accumulated from all three. Or they could qual today with the four. They just need one good win, one big win, I would say.
That'll put them way high up on the leaderboard. And Codes just went out a few minutes ago, so we should be in a game any second now.
Oh, yeah. I'd say usually around 70 players plus. We start getting more. I mean, this qualifier, like I said, you don't get any money for this one, but it's always a good practice. It's like scrims basically, at this point.
Yes. But then again, those mythics last game, we were playing them well. A lot of other teams were also picking them up and playing them. I've noticed. There's a couple teams playing earthbending. A lot of teams playing airbending. Probably one of the most powerful rotational devices
just coming out yesterday. It's still hard to get used to that new mobility change. As previously we did have grappler blades from last season. Those were always the best, but now I mean at least they're trying to add new mobility into the game. Hopefully these stay around at least until next season, just so they can add a new mobility item. I did see that one of our teams did have the airbending. But they did kind of get pushed by another team that did have it. Yes. And the other team did get that initial knock on Llama. So it was unfortunate. They couldn't really just run away because you had to just push to try to get your teammate back up.
Yes, and the black team with droids getting Dark getting knocked and droids not having that flowberry fizz that he had, he just could not get out of Storm.
Yeah, and picking it back up, we are in game two with Team Black as of right now. They're leaning back at their previous Reckless Railways on the left side of the POI. This is probably the good side. This is where last season the old Mythic was. So you still get that vault that was downstairs. This time it's just opened already. So you can get extra gold and then some maybe like one or two chests that are downstairs.
Yeah, Reckless Railways has multiple chests in it, and you can play it really well if you get set up for it. Looks like Droids is getting some earthbending for his team there. And, it's just Dark with a gold sniper already off spawn. That could be a really special item towards that progression of the game.
Oh, yeah. No, like... Well, I mean, we did see last game Dark with a nice snipe in that before the end of each other. Snipers definitely in zero build. You can't run away. You can't do much. It is a really good tag so that you can push that team before, getting any initial they get any initial damage onto you.
Looks like our white team is back at Grand Glacier. So far, it looks like they are just looting up, trying to get as much. Loot as they can to just get in the progression of the game. And
game two, the uncontested as well. We do see this is Crimson's drop spot. So It's really weird to see that there is no one landing here. This is a really good POI, I would say. You do get the, as well as last season, the Mythic was here too. So there is a vault downstairs with that gold. And having that gold, there, the you can purchase the gold from like for hills out of vending machines, or just like if you want to buy a Mythic out the vending machines.
Yeah, those vending machines, that gold can really help you get better loot for the rest of the game, really. And here we are trying to see how much gold it is to buy a purple sniper from the AI that spawns on Grand Glacier.
Yeah, with this AI, it has a sniper. It does have the rift as well as part of as she gives you. So they could use the rift to get to a different area as quick. As we see right now, we do have Llama with a sniper and impulses and medkits for his heals. I don't know if that's the best way to like have make sure you have heals, but I don't see any shield pots or anything that they have found yet.
I have not seen any shield pots they have found yet. But a shield could be really crucial because once that overshield gets away, then they're just tagging you for shield, and you just need as much health as you can. They're not really tagging you for whites yet unless you're in Storm.
Yeah, back to Team Black, still here in Reckless. No one contested them. Very empty POI. So they could probably loot up and get out of here quick, or they could play here until the end game since they know no one's here, so they could have the advantage on a team that pushes in.
I see Droids is carrying Cluster Clingers. Most you could damage some people with them. They put off a lot of damage if you throw them in the right spots, but they got to be careful because if they don't throw them in the right spots, they could come back and damage them as well.
Yeah, I mean, maybe I'm not 100% on this. I do know that the clusters, they're not like the regular clingers. The range on them when you're tossing them is not that very far, so you could accidentally just throw it at yourself and be stuck in a situation that you do not want to be in.
Exactly. We also see Droids carrying the newly added since about last week hand cannon. Yeah, we're going to see how that plays into his arsenal here.
Yeah, the hand cannon. I mean, we've seen this hand cannon multiple times. This is a different variation of the hand cannon that was added into Fortnite. It does, for like the purple, it has like 157 headshot damage. So it could be used just like a sniper. I mean, the only downfall is that you have to like peek out farther just to see, just because that drop off is horrible.
It also has tremendous, the bullet drop is terrible. There is a car driving away from them. They're still just not engaging, trying to get those placement points, and just try to get as many points as they can for that.
All right, Team White. Still in Grand Glacier, just farm. They're at the motel part though, so this is just like another like 100-200 meters out from like where they were landed, making sure they get the extra gold. I do know that these washer machines that are right below Andy here, they do drop a lot of gold as well when you break them. So just extra gold vending. There is a vending machine outside of this motel. I don't know exactly what it sells, but it does can add extra, like if it's like meds, snipers, it's always a good thing to buy.
Yes, and those medkits Llama's carrying, they could be ended up for possibly just sitting in Storm for a little bit, like playing even more passive. Now, as we can see, Andy has already obtained some airbending, which is probably going to prove very useful in the forthcoming game.
Yeah, I mean, back to Team Black, going back onto the train as it was before, and there's these four chests. They are going to hack this crate that's on the train. It takes a little while. You have to ride the train for a while to get this crate, which they might just ride out, just hide in the corners, make sure no one spots them. But if this train does go past a team, it does indicate that someone is opening the chest.
Yes. It looks like they might just be taking all the loot off the train to get stocked up and stay at railways, it looks like, almost.
Yeah, hopping off the train, making sure, grabbing that gold pistol, it looks like. Very good pistol. The pistols in Fortnite are really good.
So is that new Warforged assault rifle. That can put out, it has a very fast fire rate. Some more recoil than the Nemesis, but it can really prove some damage output in the game.
As Droids and Dark Heroes, this team fighting up at the tower, Most likely shooting at the AIs that do spawn inside of this tower. They might try to go and contest this team, because if they do get this set of this tower, I mean, they get the knowledge of where the next circle is so that they can at least try to make a plan to get there before other teams do.
Yes, the tower has just gotten taken from that team. Now we're just trying to get visuals. We're probably going to run back to railways, yep, as we are trying to disengage from this fight.
Yeah, res right now, just making sure they stay safe. There's, I mean, this is just like basic 101 for most Cruiser Bowl teams.
Yes, and as we're still looting with our no-build white team, and looks like we're still carrying medkits and earthbending. Earthbending, probably one of the most used so far in the game, and airbending, especially airbending. Airbending has the most mobility in the game, I believe, so far. Yeah. Just with a 10-second cooldown.
Just and coming out just yesterday, these mythics, I mean, their spawn rate are not the biggest. They're not the greatest, I would say. You do have to try to find them. I do know that different POIs do have, like, a shrine that spawns in them that you can get a mythic. And it does show on everyone's map. So if a team really wants to get, like, airbending or the earth wall, they might just try to contest the whoever's leading there.
Yeah, exactly. Just looting up near the junction. Our build white team might have, nope, they probably did not, but they might have gotten the tower. They might have.
They, if you see in their corner, there is no tower icon right in their minimap that you would usually see if someone gets the tower.
All right.
Going back into the same spot they were last game, this spot did put them into a top 17 situation. So, I mean, it's not the worst, not the best. They did know there was two teams around them at the moment, knowing one took in tower. And as you see right now, the bunker is appearing on map, so the bunker should be opening soon, which will bring more teams into that area.
I'm assuming they're just hoping for storm pull so they can stay on that high ground as long as they can. And it looks like Droids is having a little early celebration there for the match. Just having a little couple dances there. As we see our white team still need to go to circle, but they're just sitting in that bush for as many points as they can get. Late rotates.
Yeah, with this late rotating, I mean, just playing with the storm, walking with the storm is always the best idea. I mean, you definitely know there's no one's behind you, so all you have to do is walk in. The only issue with this late rotate is that a lot of teams like to sit on the edge of circle already in there.
Yes, and yes. And, you know, just I can still see they still got some movement. I'm pretty sure Llama has some impulses, if I last checked. And they could probably get to zone pretty quickly if they had to. So they're not in a terrible situation. They could wait till the very last second to rotate and still rotate maybe onto a team or just into zone, into another bush or something.
That's true. I mean, if you just seen a kill feed, we just seen a Varus Sekro. He knocked a player and then got eliminated right after. That is our team gold, which is really unfortunate. But they did already qualify, so, I mean, you don't have to see much. We do see Team Black just emoing around, you know, just trying to get those nerves out before they actually have to fight a team.
Having a little bit of fun.
As of right now, back to Team White, they are finally rotating into that circle. They do see and visualize the sound effects of shooting behind them and in front of them, which they might just not try to take the fight. They're really just trying to get that placement before they actually get an elim. Elims really don't, they only matter if you do get like one person like pretty lit up before you actually push. Besides that, placements are always the first thing that you need to think of.
Yes, they're trying to stay hidden as much as possible, rotating from bush to bush. And hopefully trying to spot a team before they spot them. And, you know, they're just trying to get, like I said earlier, they're just trying to get those points, trying to get qualified for this championship next week.
Yeah. One of the worst things about the sniper that Andy is currently running, it has the four times, which is the only sight in the game that actually has a glare on it. Just as well as Dark, he's running the four times on his sniper. Just when you aim it in, that glare in bushes, teams can spot it so quick. They do spot a team rotating in on them on the left side. 121 on a player in the back with a knock. So they're pretty much going to push this team right now, just trying to get that finish so the team doesn't, his teammate doesn't back up and revive him. You see Droids here to the right pushing forward, making sure that he can put pressure onto the other one's teammate before he gets there.
They Droids just passed the guy, I'm pretty sure. I'm pretty sure he was holed up in that house and they just didn't realize it. So now they're just trying to make sure they get that kill before they do any more movements towards the next guy.
Yeah, knowing that this other duo is a solo now, they might just try to play him out to see if he tries to get his card, or they might try to get a pick on him later. There is another team that rotated up into the ruins area of this POI.
Now, this could prove some trouble if that team does stay up there, because now they have the high ground, and it could end up in bad terms.
And we see as Dark right now with Droid is just pushing forward, trying to see if they can spot this team before they spot them.
Yeah, or trying to get this high ground back. There's multiple options. You got to be careful. They could be in one of those bushes.
Just looking around. They did spot him earlier, Dark with a sniper looking at him. They've seen that he went towards Reckless more, but they don't know if he's just hiding in a bush or if he's actually just trying to rotate around to try to find his teammate's cardigan to get a revive off.
Yes, and as we see, we're just sitting in both teams are just sitting in bushes trying to...
The bush strat does work. A lot of teams can qual just for playing just bush to bush. Not many people like to check bushes. You got your occasional teams that just shoot at them just to see if there's a team there. But if you miss your shot when you just randomly shoot by it, are you really going to check that bush?
Yeah, exactly. I can't lie. Bush strats really do work, and it wouldn't be really a fair state game without a bush strat.
Yeah, I mean, last semester we had our teams played bushes. Now this semester we're playing bushes. I mean, the bush is the most iconic thing in Fortnite, I would say, as well as Crimson and Gold have played in multiple bushes this semester as well.
Yes, as I remember from last season, they have taken out bush bombs this season, so that's playing another crucial role in this game, is you can't put bushes down. So if you destroy a bush, that means another team can't hide in it, and they can't throw another one down.
Yeah, I mean, bush bombs were like one of my favorite. Currently, Llama and Andy is spotting a team that's using the Air Mythic. They might try to take some picks at them. Maybe not. I mean, this team looks like they were just trying to rotate away to go find another team that they actually can spot. Just again, in the bush, relating. There is, if you do look at the map, there is a mythic on their left side, which could be the Siphon Medallion, or it could be the Dash Medallion.
It looks like a team is rolling up right next to them. We might take some shots here, or just let them go by to save that placement points. Because there are teams all around them, and if they do give their location away, then all those teams could be focusing them.
Yeah, a lot of teams do like to just listen to that fight, because a third party can always help a team out, definitely when they're not being focused.
It's really whoever gets spotted first. If you get spotted first, you could be in trouble with Droid's trying to get the car out, and Dark is hopping in the car now. They're going to rotate zone. And see what they can do.
Yeah, one of the worst things about being on keyboard and mouse is just driving.
Yes.
It's one of the hardest issues for any keyboard and mouse player.
Getting on top of the building, we're going to see. They might have spotted somebody in this house the way they're acting. I do see some footsteps on Droid's screen. So we're going to see how they play this and how they engage it.
Yeah, knowing that Team Black is, they're very smart. They know when to push a team and when not to push a team. As of right now, they do know that Solo probably is still lurking around. They did not get that finish on him fully. So he's probably just lurking. And knowing that they only saw one footstep, they might be confident enough just to push this person. But it could always be a duo that just randomly appeared into this POI.
Yeah, staying on these buildings is probably kind of key, because all across the river from Reckless, it's basically all open area. It could, unless you find a bush or something like that, you could be in a sticky situation.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing that you have really covering you around this area is trees. But, like, there's many bushes on the far left side of this area for Reckless. But if you see where Dark's looking right now, it's pretty much just open hills. As we see Team White rotating in, knowing that there is two Mythics to their left, they might not want to take this fight. Maybe getting shot in their back right now. You did see the visual effects right behind them.
I also see that Andy is not carrying any type of protection like earth wall, bunker, or shield bubble wise. So we're going to see how he plays, probably playing off of Llama. And I'm not really seeing a lot of stuff from Llama there for cover. So we're going to see how they use their natural cover most likely to play this game two of the qualifier.
Yeah, Andy and High Ground just putting damage on that car, trying to get that team out of the car. Team hops out. They're putting pressure. 116 from Andy. Knowing one is lit, but getting tagged back. Has to back up to try to heal.
That water bending can really do some put off some damage on our team here. And so we're just trying to like stay back, get a couple tags on them, and just not even push them. Just let them drive away.
Llama seeing another team rolling up in another car. This car looking very weak, so they might just try to spray this one quickly to see if this team will hop out. Shield bubbling on the car, knowing they can't really shoot back at it no more. It looks like a solo just trying to revive.
Yes, that car, the car just exploded, and now it probably did some damage to their players. And we're still just staying up on this mountain looking for some easy eliminations.
Yeah, multiple teams just in cars. Knowing that, like, in Nace, they did leave the cars into the game, so people are just using the cars to their advantage, trying to get to different areas of the map. We do see Lou Island right to their right, so they might try to use the rifts to, like, at least rotate into the circle so they don't have to get, sprayed on it, like, with no mobility.
We do see Llama put that earthbending wall down. Now, it could, the 10-second cooldown, it could end up really nice for them in endgame with that, because they have portable cover. They keep on moving and keep on putting cover down. But they also got to remember that once they put another one down, it's gonna just that last rock ball is just going to disappear.
Yeah, now we just see Andy trying to get his green health back, staying in storm just to hit a heal. Back to Team Black. I mean, they did get that second elim, I did see. So they did get a full wipe on a team. Right now, just sitting in the bush, got a perfect zone right on top of them, so they do not have to move. Hearing shots to their left and to their right, they do know there's a team in this bunker to their right, though.
Got people airbending right next to them. They're trying to stay completely passive so they don't give away their location other than a free kill. One of the teams could stand still, and it could prove useful for them.
And right there, you're just seeing Dark with a 121 tag on the team behind the rock. They're not gonna push that just because they do know there's multiple teams looking at that, so it's not worth it. But wasting those men for other teams is always a key part when you're pushing the end game.
I also see
pushing his team in a car. Just he's switching seats, running away with the elim.
Nice elim by our Ferris Black team.
Back to Team White. They're moving into circle now. No, they have no cover besides the earth wall.
Which.
Another team rolling up on team. Droids knocked to a John Wick skin, but
Droids picked up the kill right there after Dark got knocked.
Using the bunkers for cover.
Another team rolls up. Droids just has to get out of there. Otherwise, he could be in a predicament. Five teams HP. All around him. There's nothing he could have done. And they placed eighth on the leaderboard.
Eighth with four kills, right?
I believe
not
so.
Not too bad. Back with Team White. You know, they're sitting pretty good right now. Not many teams find them. The Mythics are on the opposite side of the whole.
They're getting a pretty good position for high ground. They found another bush that they're going to sit in for the time being.
Ferris,
they will
in their
have
bushes.
To move out of that bush pretty soon here to get into zone.
Yeah, zone is just like you see right now. There's a lot of moving zones that Fortnite have added, which is it helps to try to eliminate the most people so that it's not everyone just sitting in one circle. But it really it hurts when you don't have any cover to, like, block yourself, I would say. Yep. Knowing that this guy's a solo, Andy with a 34 tag on him, they're going to push this. This guy with many impulses in his inventory, they just can't key this person. Yep. Another team rolling up.
They're starting to get surrounded by players. They got to keep an eye on the team south, like, across the train bridge here. Otherwise, they could possibly get pinched and fall into some trouble as Llama just gets sniped out of nowhere by another team. He puts a rock wall down to try to cover himself, and
no shields
and
for
he's
Llama.
Just trying to get across the bridge.
Andy looking for a snipe on one of these teams just to try to do damage to them. Bunkering up on the bridge, really hard for Andy right now because Lama's the only one that has any cover. And they still have to do this long rotate up north.
Okay, Lama, rotate back.
Team
and
behind.
From behind, get a snipe from that guy, and they also have placed eighth on the leaderboard.
Top eight. I mean, not horrible, not the worst, but, you know, those extra placement points, I would say, is always worth it.
But also, on our no-build black team, I noticed that before Dark died, he wasn't carrying any movement or anything to protect himself with builds. He had a sniper, an AR, a shotgun, and just meds.
Yeah. Well, looking at that, this game two just ended. It's going to be a while before it ends, so we're just going to take this to a break real quick, and then right when those lobby codes come out for game three, we'll be right back, okay?
And sophomores as we grow up play, so it's I think it's a great opportunity for a freshman to come in and play early.
Coaching staff here at Ferris is great. We had a good coaching staff the last 3 years I've been here, but for my senior year we had a new staff come in. Dan Underwood came in from Arizona State and brought along an excellent staff with him. I think the next 3 years the team will improve a lot, and it's a young team, and they brought in 45 recruits, and between those guys I think they're going to have a real football dynasty in the next 3 years.
I think the programs are fine also. It's a variety of programs that you can go into. They have something for everyone.
I think the coaching staff is great. All the new coaches came in, brought a lot of freshmen in, and let everybody see what they can do, and told all the players that all the jobs was open.
I like most about Ferris is that you're an individual up here, and people understand you, they know you, and you're not treated like just another number like you would be at another school possibility. And it's just, you're treated as one, an individual.
I really like the coaching staff. They're really nice. They're young coaching staff, and I think they'll take us to the championship.
What I like most about Ferris is the campus life. There's a lot of activities on campus here at Ferris. You meet a lot of interesting people, and there's just a lot of things to do for you.
Our coaching staff is very enthusiastic, very excited, always keep you pumped up and ready for the game, from during season and off season.
To help build the special skills required to create a winning team, Dan Underwood brought in his own coaching assistants. Underwood believes that you win on defense. He also knows that you can't win without a good blend of running and throwing. Can't forget the fan support. Football is an important part of Ferris State College. Athletes learn about teamwork, personal commitment, and they all reach for that common goal, success. Industry, opportunity, education. The ideas upon which Woodbridge and Ferris founded the institution, and 100 years later, are still the driving force behind Ferris's success, not only in the classroom, but out on the field. Thank you. Ferris State College, an attitude of success that started in the mind of one great man, Woodbridge N. Ferris. A former governor of Michigan and United States Senator, Ferris founded the institution 100 years ago. His intent was to provide a practical education for any person with the motivation and potential to benefit. Initially known as the Ferris Industrial School, it became the Ferris Institute at the turn of the century. In 1950, Ferris became a state college with a growing national recognition for its dedication to educational success. However, tragedy struck as fire swept through the college, consuming most of its beautiful campus and its past. But its spirit could not be quelled. From the ashes rose a new and greater commitment to success, growing at an unprecedented rate. Still located where it was founded 100 years ago in the scenic Muskegon River Valley, Ferris now boasts a new campus accommodating its over 100 career-oriented programs. Ferris's most popular school is the School of Business, boasting a wide variety of programs in business and management fields. Established nearly a century ago, Ferris's School of Pharmacy remains one of the most prestigious pharmacy schools in the Midwest. More than half of all practicing pharmacists.
Welcome back. Game three. We're here with Team Black waiting back at their reckless relays in the same area. I mean, we've seen some good things from them last game.
Yep.
I mean, look, key pointers, they did get into a good top eight that game.
Good top eight. Landing 15 points on the board with five kills. So we're going to see if they can do roughly the same thing probably and see if they can even get more kills and possibly more placement.
Yeah, I mean, because probably right now they really need those ALEM points. That's probably going to separate them from any of the top teams currently right now.
Exactly. Those ALEM points, it's one per player. So if they can get a duo, then that's automatically 2 points. If they run across like three of them at the start, then that's automatically 6 points. That can really start to tally up as the game progresses.
Yeah, now we're here at Team White at Grand Glacier. Same thing again, no contesting. I mean, this is always a good sign for any team. When you have a POI to yourself, you can just load up any of the crates, any of those ammo crates. You get your like perfect loadout that you want before a team actually pushes you.
Yeah, both teams still unconned. Really surprising. I'm wondering where all these teams are actually landing across the map, because we're seeing a few teams rotate into Reckless Railways. And usually our white team just travels out of the Grand Glacier, and they don't really run into a team for a little bit.
Yeah, and then now we see the train actually early this time back for Team Black. They might just try to hop on here like they did before, grab that extra loot, grab those extra shields, throw them to the side. I mean, you see right there, you have the banana. I mean, this banana is always good to carry over a medkit, in my opinion, because you get that green health that recharges over time. Plus, you get that ability just to move fast.
Yeah, just like the Zeus medallion, you get the sprint effect, which enables you to sprint faster, and you get a higher jump rate, almost like a Flowberry Fizz type situation.
Yeah, I think the only big issue is with those bananas is that your sprint runs out very quick.
Yeah.
As you see, we have is the Air Mythic again for Andy.
I think that's the water mythic.
The water, I mean, okay, with the water, this is a good one, though. I mean, you can heal inside of any water area. Like, exactly. Even in this little puddle, you could just heal. I mean, it's always better to carry over medkits, in my opinion, because you can do damage with this as well.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's 5 seconds, 5 health points per second, which is really nice for there's water across the map. You could just jump in that water, and you can heal your health right up to where it needs to be.
Yeah, and I mean, we've seen in the kill feed, we've seen Varus Zekro one more time, Team Go, getting elims. I mean, he's just not on stage, so we can't see his POV, but I mean, still try to give him a little acknowledgement in the game.
Exactly. He's playing solo, too. That's really brave of him to play solo, you know, getting as many points as he can for his team while his teammate
currently couldn't be here.
Yeah, I mean, definitely is playing solo in these collegiate games is not as easy as people think. I mean, a lot of these people play days on end trying to get better, making sure that their rotates are good, making sure that they know the whole POY by heart.
Exactly. Another banana Dart picks up. That could it could prove very useful towards the end of the game where they're starting to take storm damage and such.
Yeah, they could use it as ability to go into storm and try to rotate around so they don't have to fight teams.
Yes, they could.
I mean, as we did see game two, they got kind of pressured by two different teams. So having that ability just to go back into storm and pop a banana and then rotate out of there and still be full health is always a good thing.
I do see Dark also picked up the water bending. That could also prove useful for storm rotates, even when you're going into zone and you can heal up as you're rotating, really.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what I did multiple times. Is we usually picked up any mythic that we found. Definitely water. Water is a crucial one for this mythic. It does a lot of damage. It's, in my opinion, probably better than most ARs or SMGs, even in close range.
I agree. Andy having an Earth mythic, testing how to throw how the rock projectile works, I see, and just kind of looking for players to Elim. Just sitting in that bush trying to get those points.
Yeah, I mean, right now, again, bush camping, this is always the best thing to do. You really do not want to push teams. If you don't feel confident in yourself and your aim, it's one of the biggest issues with most players. They just don't feel confident. But, I mean, I do trust that Team White, they feel like they can, if they need to take a fight, they will take a fight. As of right now, I do know Andy doesn't really play much of the game. And he's not really of a zero build player. He's more of a build player. But just to see him, you know, trying his best, getting those elims, it's always a good thing.
Talking to Poseidon, he could possibly buy some Chug Splashes or that purple AR, which could prove useful in the end game. Those that Warforged AR, like I was saying earlier, it could put out some damage, but like starting to go towards long range, you're going to need a vertical grip or something to control that recoil on it.
Yeah, no, with these guns this season, like the recoil on them are very horrible. And, I mean, you have to pull down pretty much over and over just to maybe get one hit on a player. But up close, I mean, you can use it over an SMG, in my opinion, and just use it for a secondary.
As we see, Dark and Droids hear some people on the hills and mountains, maybe possibly in the POI itself, shooting up somewhere, possibly trying to reel in players, or maybe even in a fight. And they're just trying to get a visual, trying to get up to their high ground that they were at before to get that advantage over the other team.
Yeah, we can see that team looks like they were currently shooting at the AIs that just spawned in at the tower. So they're probably just trying to make sure they get that key card. And I mean, we see that Team Black doesn't really want to push them. They just want to get back up into their high ground, you know, play their little end game, make sure that they're ready to actually fight a team when it gets into that tough situation when everyone's just close up on each other.
Exactly.
All right, we see here right now, you see Dark's running a pistol over an AR. I mean, honestly, the pistol close range, it's accuracy is, there's not much bullet drop off that I've seen over time. So it's really good. To me, probably even better than an AR up close.
Yeah, especially close range. Close range, it really annihilates people. But far range, you start to get that. It's almost like bullet drop and recoil at the same time.
Recoil, damage drop off,
inconsistent, and damage drop off. Like there's a lot of things. But he also has the drum mag on. I don't really feel like the drum mag is that great for the pistol. I'd rather probably prefer the speed grip because it gives you four, the drum mag gives you like 7 extra bullets maybe, and then the 13 one, you just speed reload. Meanwhile, the drum mag, you actually gotta reload the natural time.
Yeah, I mean, with the drum mag, it does add in that extra ability just to hold down your trigger and let it just, you know, spray. Back to Team White here, we see as Llama and Andy in a bush, they do spot a team that is currently running towards Reckless with the thermo. Talking about the thermo sight, in my opinion, probably not the best sight, but it does help in these situations where you're not expecting somebody to be, and you just aim in, and you can just see the heat outline from a player.
But also, I think what they could potentially upgrade on it is seeing people through bushes. I mean, it would be probably kind of broken, but, you know, like,
it wouldn't prove that useful if you couldn't. You know what I mean?
That is true. I mean, with the thermal being able to see through bushes would help a lot of players, definitely in zero build, just to spot someone that's in a bush that's hiding.
Yeah, I mean, you wouldn't, like, try to... If you try to... it would be kind of broken seeing people through bushes for people trying to hiding. But it wouldn't necessarily be that useful without being able to see through bushes, because you could use basically any scope during the game and see the same amount.
That is true. As we just seen it get in kill feed, Zekro, again, pushing teams just as a solo, doing as much damage and kills as he can get for any points.
Yes, yes. As we see Dark here using the Water Myth against some tags on these people running away, trying to get that final Elim after doing 72 white damage to him, and it looks like they're getting away now. Oh, he gets the knock!
With the knock from Dark, with this Water Mythic, they're definitely going to just push this, knowing that they have the advantage. With the Impulse and a Flow Berry, this just increases how far they can actually go just a normal way.
He's in the bush. Dark doing major damage with the water bending. Mega over 250 damage. And another Elim.
Two eliminations from Dark, definitely with that Water Mythic. As we come back to Team White, there's a team on top of them fighting, and another team on top of a mountain. One knock from Andy, the other one trying to get away, just trying to escape from Andy's spray. Using this Water Mythic, throwing a bunker. As you've seen, that player just hit the tire off of the bunker, which is one of the biggest issues with the bunkers.
Yes, if you hit those tires, you get stuck in a position you don't want to be in away from that bunker. You want to be as close to that thing as you can, and those tires will just push you right away from it. Looks like Llama is trying to get some snipes up on the mountain, trying to get rid of some of that high ground pressure that they're receiving.
Yeah, we can see that there's pressure. They're using an enemy's bunker to just try to hide behind. Not having, besides the earth wall in Andy's inventory for cover, knowing that this team might just push him, they might try to back up and get in a different position so they have the advantage over this team.
They do have that island all around them, so unless the other team has air bending, then they can't really get over to him that fast, and they're most likely going to see him.
That is true. Getting that water can like prove a very, very bad, troubling for anyone, even as Team White. If they go in that water, teams can just spray him without any builds.
Exactly, exactly. As we see, Andy's running a AR burst, which I think the waterbending is almost better than the burst. And he's also running waterbending.
That is true. I mean, having that burst, I mean, it's a very slow rate firing gun. So, like, I mean, long range, not the best. Up close, amazing. I mean, it hits hard. Definitely being in a purple variant, so you get that increased damage just for the rarity. Definitely the output, too. Just having that burst that can actually spray through someone's bunker and try to do damage to the bunker as quick as they can would be a really good thing.
Andy and Llama a little bit separate here, trying to figure out how to play with all these teams around them at fencing fields. Probably shouldn't be away that far from your teammate, because that could, if one person gets tagged for a lot, then you need, it looks like Dark is knocked, and Droids has to figure something out here, possibly trying to revive.
Sees the player above him, throws on a bunker, the bunker goes above him, does do a good tag on him. This player did shoot the AI, so the AI is currently shooting back at him. Droids might just push back to Dark and try to get the revive off.
Dark is very low health. If he does not get the revive here, then and it looks like something happened where Dark got eliminated. Droids does not know how that happened, it looks like.
Yeah, but Droids does have the reboot, and there is a reboot vein right outside of this POI. The other player that he was fighting did get an elimination by the AI that was in the area, so they didn't have to worry about him too much. Droids might just go for this reboot that's right on top of them, since they know the other team is in a fight.
There is a bunker on the ground right next to him that he could possibly use to put on the reboot to revive. And as Droids is possibly going to another reboot, so he gets away from this team.
Disengaging, making sure that he's safe. He might go back to this lumber mill that is on the top north of this area. Maybe a team hiding here. We do got to be careful of that, though.
using more Flowberry Fizz and impulses to get over to this reboot van even faster. Just looking around to make sure nobody's here. Sitting in the car to make sure nobody rolls up on them and tries to eliminate droids.
Another team rolling up in another vehicle. Droid's just making sure he doesn't make any sound so this team doesn't ever expect that there's a solo in this area.
As Droids lets the car just go right by him, trying to let them go up the mountain, getting them as far away as he can. He will then possibly try to reboot, even though there is another team fighting right next to him.
As we go back to Team White, Team White currently in fencing, two eliminations to their name, just looking for anybody that they can try to fight. Staying on top of this roof, probably not the best situation. You're just leaving yourself in a wide open for a sniper to just
59 damage with a hand cannon from that far away. That's pretty impressive.
As we see, there is another player inside the POI with them, shooting him from the opposite side. They're just looking for some quick tags on him, looking if they can get an angle. As you see right here, Llama does have a sniper, so one good headshot would put them in a good advantage for this team.
Andy and Llama playing pretty open. They got to watch out for the left side. If the team on the left sees them, they could get into some trouble here.
As we do see it in the north, that there is a medallion on the map just running around. They might have to worry about this player actually pushing over and keying them. It would be a bad situation for both of them because the only cover they do have is an earth wall.
They also have 40 seconds till the zone starts to move. So they will have to rotate zone pretty quickly. They either have to figure out how to rotate without engaging this team, or they have to take their chances and engage them and then rotate.
Yeah, as we see, going back to Team Black, Droids still with the reboot card of Darks has a player arriving at the lumber wheel with them. We'll see if he actually fights this, or is he going to hide and just make sure that he doesn't get eliminated so that he can get his teammate back up.
Only
and get
meds to his name are the bananas, but those bananas could prove really useful.
That's true. 10 fizz, not much. Carrying using it just to move.
It could possibly be another solo, but Droids will not take that chance, and he will continue to move, trying to get to zone. Zone looks pretty far on the map already, and he has 45 seconds, so he's trying to get there without rising any attention to himself.
Yeah, knowing that there's a medallion to his right, he's just trying to make sure he pays attention. Llama and Andy currently in a fight at Factory, sitting on another team behind them. This is one of the issues about like playing late. You know, with that storm pushing up on you, you have to. It's really scary.
They're in a truck now. 200.
Ferris State College, an attitude of success that started in the mind of one great man, Woodbridge N. Ferris. A former governor of Michigan and United States Senator, Ferris founded the institution 100 years ago. His intent was to provide a practical education for any person with the motivation and potential to benefit. Initially known as the Ferris Industrial School, it became the Ferris Institute at the turn of the century. In 1950, Ferris became a state college with a growing national recognition for its dedication to educational success. However, tragedy struck as fire swept through the college, consuming most of its beautiful campus and its past. But its spirit could not be quelled. From the ashes rose a new and greater commitment to success, growing at an unprecedented rate. Still located where it was founded 100 years ago in the scenic Muskegon River Valley, Ferris now boasts a new campus accommodating its over 100 career-oriented programs. Ferris's most popular school is the School of Business, boasting a wide variety of programs in business and management fields. Established nearly a century ago, Ferris's School of Pharmacy remains one of the most prestigious pharmacy schools in the Midwest. More than half of all practicing pharmacists in Michigan hail from Ferris. The newest addition to Ferris is the College of Optometry, the only such school in Michigan and one of 14 in the nation. Ferris's place at the forefront of technical education is maintained by the Schools of Education and Technology. Career-oriented hands-on training in all of Ferris's programs produce an overall job placement rate of over 90%. This combined with student dedication has made success a tradition at Ferris for over 100 years. The 1984 centennial celebration saw the arrival of a new Ferris State College president, J. William Winrick. His plan is to renew the commitment to practical education that Woodbridge N. Ferris made over a century ago.
Ferris will maintain its distinctive mission of training people for careers, for professions, occupations, that it does so well. And the difference will be primarily in these new occupations, new technologies. As society and technology changes, we're going to change to respond to that. The basic mission won't change at all.
Another new face is head football coach Dan Underwood. He comes fresh from shining successes as defensive assistant for Central Michigan, Michigan State, and most recently, Arizona State, where he helped coach the defensive team to the number one spot in the nation.
Really, Dan Underwood is a superb coach. He's a great guy, great human being. He's starting new, first year as I am at the college. He's bringing in his own system, his own people, his own assistants. He's educating and training players in the way he wants them to do. This year we've had a heavily freshman team, got kids who are coming in for the first time with Dan. And I'm really excited about what he's doing and can do.
Dan Underwood's goal for the Bulldogs is to be the best Division II team in the country. This may take some time, but he's very optimistic.
We're a very, very young program, and we're excited about the future. And we look for very, very good things to happen here.
Freshmen are vital to the football team and should expect to see some action on the field their first year at Ferris.
A young man, if he's interested in coming in and playing early, he can do that at Ferris State. And we had 54 freshmen this last fall. And we had at one time as many as 14 start for us. So I think next year and the years to come, you're going to see freshmen and sophomores as we grow up play. So I think it's a great opportunity for a freshman to come in and play early.
Coaching staff here at Ferris is great. We had a good coaching staff the last 3 years I've been here, but for my senior year we had a new staff come in, Dan Underwood came in from Arizona State and brought along an excellent, you know, staff with him. I think the next 3 years the team will improve a lot, and it's a young team, and they brought in 45 recruits, and between those guys, I think they're gonna have a, you know, a real football dynasty in the next 3 years.
I think the programs are fine also. You know, it's a variety of programs that you can go into. You know, they have something for everyone.
I think the coaching staff is great. All the new coaches came in, brought a lot of freshmen in, and let everybody see what they can do, and told all the players that all the jobs was open.
I like most about Ferris is that you're an individual up here and people understand you, they know you, and you're not treated like just another number like you would be at another school possibility. And it's just, you're treated as one, an individual.
I really like the coaching staff. They're really nice. They're young coaching staff, and I think they'll take us to the championship.
What I like most about Ferris is the campus life. There's a lot of activities on campus here at Ferris. You meet a lot of interesting people, and there's just a lot of things to do for you.
Our coaching staff is very enthusiastic, very excited. Always keep you pumped up and ready for the game. You can be doing season and off season.
To help build the special skills required to create a winning team, Dan Underwood brought in his own coaching assistants. Underwood believes that you win on defense. He also knows that you can't win without a good blend of running and throwing. And you can't forget the fan support. Football is an important part of Ferris State College. Athletes learn about teamwork, personal commitment, and they all reach for that common goal, success. Industry, opportunity, education. The ideas upon which Woodbridge and Ferris founded the institution, and 100 years later, are still the driving force behind Ferris's success, not only in the classroom, but out on the field. Ferris State College, an attitude of success that started in the mind of one great man, Woodbridge N. Ferris. A former governor of Michigan and United States Senator, Ferris founded the institution 100 years ago. His intent was to provide a practical education for any person with the motivation and potential to benefit. Initially known as the Ferris Industrial School, it became the Ferris Institute at the turn of the century. In 1950, Ferris became a state college with a growing national recognition for its dedication to educational success. However, tragedy struck as fire swept through the college, consuming most of its beautiful campus and its past. But its spirit could not be quelled. From the ashes rose a new and greater commitment to success, growing at an unprecedented rate. Still located where it was founded 100 years ago in the scenic Muskegon River Valley, Ferris now boasts a new campus accommodating its over 100 career-oriented programs. Ferris's most popular school is the School of Business, boasting a wide variety of programs in business and management fields. Established nearly a century ago, Ferris's School of Pharmacy remains one of the most prestigious pharmacy schools in the Midwest. More than half of all practicing pharmacists in Michigan hail from Ferris. The newest addition to Ferris is the College of Optometry, the only such school in Michigan and one of 14 in the nation. Ferris's place at the forefront of technical education is maintained by the schools of education and technology. Career-oriented hands-on training in all of Ferris's programs produce an overall job placement rate of over 90%. This combined with student dedication has made success a tradition at Ferris for over 100 years. The 1984 centennial celebration saw the arrival of a new Ferris State College president, J. William Winrick. His plan is to renew the commitment to practical education that Woodbridge N. Ferris made over a century ago.
Ferris will maintain its distinctive mission of training people for careers, for professions, occupations, that it does so well. And the difference will be primarily in these new occupations, new technologies. As society and technology changes, we're going to change to respond to that. The basic mission won't change at all.
Another new face is head football coach Dan Underwood. He comes fresh from shining successes as defensive assistant for Central Michigan, Michigan State, and most recently, Arizona State, where he helped coach the defensive team to the number one spot in the nation.
Clearly, Dan Underwood is a superb coach. He's a great guy, great human being. He's starting new, first year as I am at the college. He's bringing in his own system, his own people, his own assistants. He's educating and training players in the way he wants them to do. This year we've had a heavily freshman team, got kids who are coming in for the first time with Dan. I'm really excited about what he's doing and can do.
Dan Underwood's goal for the Bulldogs is to be the best Division II team in the country. This may take some time, but he's very optimistic.
We're a very, very young program, and we're excited about the future. And we look for very, very good things to happen here.
Freshmen are vital to the football team and should expect to see some action on the field their first year at Ferris.
A young man, if he's interested in coming in and playing early, he can do that at Ferris State. And we had 54 freshmen this last fall. And we had as many as 14 start for us. So I think next year and the years to come, you're going to see freshmen and sophomores as we grow up play. So I think it's a great opportunity for a freshman to come in and play early.
Coaching staff here at Ferris is great. We had a good coaching staff the last 3 years I've been here, but for my senior year, we had a new staff come in. Dan Underwood came in from Arizona State and brought along an excellent, you know, staff with him. I think the next 3 years the team will improve a lot, and it's a young team, and they brought in 45 recruits, and between those guys, I think they're gonna have a, you know, a real football dynasty in the next 3 years.
I think the programs are fine also. You know, it's a variety of programs that you can go into. You know, they have something for everyone.
I think the coaching staff is great. All the new coaches came in, brought a lot of freshmen in, and let everybody see what they can do, and told all the players that all the jobs was open.
I like most about Ferris is that you're an individual up here, and people understand you, they know you, and you're not treated like just another number like you would be at another school possibility. And it's just, you're treated as one, an individual.
Welcome back for the fourth and final game of our qualifiers. I mean, looking at the teams that we, they didn't do as bad. They placed pretty high, you know, with a 14th. And then White, you know, trying to push from fencing, getting that unlucky just spray from the back and in the front. I mean, we hope to see both teams after talking to them and see what they're trying to fix to see if they can actually get the placement points in those eliminations that we've been talking about this whole time.
Exactly. This is their final game to get as many points or qualify for the lobby as they can, really. And if they don't, then they'll be out. They won't be able to play the championship. So.
Yeah. No. This is legit their last game today, and if they do not get in the top four, they have one more chance besides that. And it's just to see if they can accumulate enough points for all three games to be able to qual for the championship game.
Exactly. We're hoping to see these teams make some more plays with the Water Mythics, of course, the Air Mythics, and the Earth Bending.
Yeah, I mean, we do see that both teams do like that earth and then air for sure, if they find them. And the water is the most liked out of both teams. I mean, being that it puts out good damage and it heals. I mean, some people haven't used it as much, so hopefully they can get that aim down and hit some shots real quick to put them in a good advantage for their teams.
As we start the game, it looks like Droids and Dark are going to their Reckless Railway spot. Possibly to keep going with the way they've been going, and hopefully some extra more placement and extra more kills.
That's true. And Team White, Llama and Andy, going back to that Grand Glacier, no one's contesting them here. So, I mean, it's always a good feeling when you're a duo and no one pushes you.
Yes,
but
always.
Maybe in this last one, they might just push them.
Ferris Zekro, I saw in chat, just did get eliminated at the very start of the game. So we will see how he feels about that after the game, but very disappointing.
Unfortunate. I mean, being that solo, just trying to push onto a duo is very hard. I mean, not having that extra person, definitely in a game where damage matters the most, and definitely with that extra shield, that adding 50 to it before you even land, it hurts when you're a solo and you don't have enough pressure built up with two people.
Exactly. You can only do so much for the... For being a solo. There's only so much you can do against a whole duo, possibly even more than one duo. And, you know, you just get really screwed by it. You got to carry twice the loot on one person, basically. And that can just go south pretty fast.
Yeah, and even if you get that, like, pressure into one person, that duo just, it hurts. Exactly. As we see Team White, they're just looting up, making sure they got the same thing, the mats, not mats, I mean meds. And they got the ammo. I mean, like I've said before, ammo is the key to this. Just so you can put down as much spray.
As much damage, as much spray as possible to get those quick elims. Or even just to damage them a little bit to let them make them know to stay away from you.
Yeah, most of the time, you're really just trying to like, tell teams, hey, we don't want you here. We're the better one here, so don't push us.
Yeah, but if you want a fight, we'll give you a fight.
We will give you the fight that you want. We're not here to be scared. I mean, as we know, these two teams are really good. They know what they're doing. They're trying their best. I mean, it's a hard thing out there trying to qual. And definitely in these nice, even when there's no prize pool, people still put their heart and try their best to get out here.
Yeah, with no build, it's not just skill. It's also luck. Like, other people, they get better. They could get, like, all gold loadout, and then they just randomly push onto Dark and Droids here, and they could just... You know, get killed from it. It's not just about skill. They have great skill, but they also have to be kind of lucky on what they get.
Yeah, a luck is a big factor in this game. Definitely for a zero build play. As Sen was saying, just having that different rarity, that extra damage output, it hurts when you only find like these common and uncommon guns in a team besides you. This has like a gold sniper or a gold shotgun and just pushes you without you even knowing.
Exactly. I'm pretty sure in almost all the games so far, Dark has started off with a great pump shotgun, which is not that lucky, but as he progresses to loot, he does pick up some greater rarity items, which really help him towards the progression of the game.
Sure. Going back to Team White here, using these portal bunkers, they do take you to different areas, as this one you've seen takes you down to the Zenith wall, which will get you, it's just a faster rotate down there, so you don't have to be in the open and just getting sprayed by a team.
I actually had no idea that was there.
Yeah, no, I've landed here pretty much majority of my games, even in qualifiers, and I have never used that portal bunker once to get down there. I usually just walk down there or impulse.
Yeah, exactly. But this plane area is a high loot area. There is about 7 chests, roughly, 8 chests, just in the water and plane area alone. And there's even 3 in the possible house.
Yeah, plus you get that extra, like, there's like 5 to 6 like barrels just around for extra heals. Definitely, if you see Llama right here, he only has 80 shield. Just looking to hit one of these barrels just to get his health up to max.
Also, the fishing spots, I've noticed that too. It looks like Llama is going to try to take advantage of this and get some fish for endgame. And I see about 4 or 5 there just right next to him. And there's at least 3 across the lake from him right now. So he could get some major health benefits later in the progression of the game.
Yeah, and recently with this new change where you can actually move and eat the fish at the same time, I mean, will help you when you're just trying to get to an area without getting, you know, killed by storm or killed by another player.
Exactly. It looks like Llama is starting off with that blue auto shotgun again. And that really, as we've seen so far, it has been proving useful to them throughout their games with the damage output.
Yeah, as I was saying before with these, like the auto, the pump is always good for if you're trying to get like a medium range tag on someone before you push, as we see with Dark with his pump. But that auto, when you're up close, you don't even have to switch from your gun. You just keep spraying.
Exactly. And sometimes that auto, you kind of need to be a little close. That's why sometimes I don't even carry a shotgun when I'm playing zero build. I go carry an AR and a SMG, and that would probably be enough because you got far to medium range and then a medium to close.
That is true. I mean, I still like that shotgun just when you're up close, but if... Most of the time, your fights are going to be from a long, mean range fight, so ARs are always the best. We see here, Dark and Droids, they're just maxing out their health, getting that gold.
Still, both drops unconned. Very surprising that no one has switched up their drops yet, but very beneficial to our teams to get early game loot. And Andy and Llama might go for this tower to get that extra knowledge for endgame.
Yeah, we see Andy here just using that air method to get to that tower as fast as he can to see if there's anybody trying to contest it first. And now you see he's just shooting at these AIs just to get eliminate them really quick. As we see, the one with the bar on above his head is the one that they have to kill to get the card to be able to activate this tower.
And it looks like they will be getting this tower. And it looks like Andy's using all-rounder drum gun, which is one of the newer weapons of the season. And it usually carries a 30 to 40 round mag and has a good decent fire rate with a good damage output. So we'll see how he uses that later in the game.
Yes, with this drum gun, not a fan favorite for most players. Knowing that that low fire rate with the high damage, it helps, but in that close range, it could be the deciding factor if you face someone with that SMG.
Exactly, but it doesn't all matter about the fire rate and the damage so much if someone's running out in the open. You can use about any type of gun to get some extra tags on them.
As we see here, they might actually be playing more aggro this last game to see if they can get some Elim points, because they're looking pretty shy on the points they have right now.
It looks like we have Droids has a stack of bunkers to his name, which can be really useful. They do see that train is being taken, so we're gonna see how they play this. If there's opponents on the train, or there are opponents on the train. I saw them in Grand Central Station, or
they're right on top of the train. Currently, right now, they might try to take some pop shots at them, but most likely not. I did talk to them before. They really said that they just really want to get those placement points first before taking a fight.
Exactly. Those placement points are key. And then once you start getting them, then you can start going for kills and getting even more placement points.
As we see here now, they're going back in that same spot they've been going to every single game. It's a very nice spot, I would say. I mean, I don't really check up here myself mostly. So just, you know, getting up here, hiding, making sure you just don't take a fight that you don't need to take. Getting to that top 17 when you get your first point for placements is just way better than pushing anyone and everyone.
Exactly. Looks like they might do something with these cars here. Maybe possibly rotate to a bunker or just get in a better position in zone. Because it looks like zone went south of them, so they got to do a small rotate out of their POI. But they might utilize those bunkers to get gold and mod their weapons.
That is true. Now we've seen Dark finally find a better shotgun, choosing to switch to that drum gun as well. I mean, one of the biggest issues with this storm pool going down south is that there is two major mythic POIs, which could be a really big deciding factor because they are all mountain, basically.
Exactly. So most of those mountains have launch pads on them. So if they could stay close to them with possibly Flowberry Fizz, then they could get good rotates out of those launch pads. And I'm pretty sure they did see that there is another team right next to them in their POI trying to get a visual on them.
Yeah, no, we just see they're just making sure to see if they can get the initial first shots out. Knowing that when you do see in someone's feet, it usually is like 10 meters, if not a little bit more. That means they're most likely around the station. They probably know that if anything, they might be just hiding in these buildings, which is a very good case for most teams.
Dark does spot him right next to the cars. He does have his clingers out. Looks like he's going to throw some clingers down to get some extra damage before they push. They did hop in the car, and it looks like the other team is trying to disengage now.
And Droid's just talking to his teammate, we don't need to push for this kill. We can just hide for a second.
Exactly. Being greedy is a very dangerous play in some of these matches where you could possibly put yourself in a situation where you're away from your teammate.
Yeah, splitting up from your teammate is the worst thing to do. When you split up from your teammate, like the one team could just pressure you so fast where you just are knocked, and then playing solo zero builds as in a duos is really hard. They do see that car that they did spot earlier shooting, and they did spot the player. He's playing on top of the hill right now. I'm guessing he is a solo at the moment.
Looks like Dark and Droids are just going to sit up here on this mountain for the time being, looking for anyone else rotating into zone and playing a passive type of gameplay to get those extra points.
And as right now, they do have an airbending mythic. I do not know about Droids if he has it. So they're probably just using this car as their rotating ability. And then we're going Droids with this thermo. This is what I was talking about, this thermo. Like, if you don't know where people are and you just aim in and look around, you could spot them, like, quickly. Yeah. And then that could be a deciding factor if you want to push them or if you want to play back and rotate around them so you don't actually start a fight.
Yep. It looks like Dark and Droids are rotating to this factory building to get a little bit more natural cover. And possibly even they could have seen a team in here, but it does not look that way. They look like they're just going to play passive and use that natural cover for their advantage later on in the match.
As we see right now, Loot Island is spawning in. This is always a good thing for most teams. A lot of teams like to just take over Loot Island just because it's a high ground. Plus, a lot of teams like to play in the bushes around it and seeing if there's, using the rifts to move around the map.
They do hear some people northeast of their position towards Grand Glacier Lake area. And they're going to probably just play passive and see if they can spot them out the window, if anything. Still trying to get those first initial placement points and then get some follow-up kills after, try to get as many points as they can.
That's true. They did look at the map, and one of the medallions are on the ground. And then they hear these two airbending mythics, and these people do not see them. I mean, blending into this wall, making sure they don't make much sound. They do know there's two teams now on them.
Somebody might be coming in, walking right up the stairs onto them, it looks like, by the visual sound effects on their screens. But they are ready. And there he is. And Dark takes the initial shots, and they do a decent amount of damage. They might even got on the, they didn't get the knock on him, and they're just going to get the kill right there.
Yeah, you can see right now the other teammate did hop in a vehicle and just left, not trying to engage in his team, just trying to get his placement points as well.
Using that safe as cover is risky business, because if anyone walks in on them, they could possibly get stuck behind that safe. It does not have a good cover area for them to hide behind.
Yeah,
so.
No, really, you're pretty much like showing your head only, and it's really hard for them. They have to get close to you to be able to see their whole body. So pretty much, you're putting yourself in an disadvantage.
Yeah, it sounds like that teammate of the car might possibly be coming back, or a whole new team. But it looks like he's just going to keep disengaged.
You see, they're just going to sit up here. They know they had a knock kill, so they're just waiting for this player to come back. Storm's closing in right now, so they're probably much just going to wait to see where that storm pulls, see if they want to, like, leave this area, if it pulls pretty far. And then most storms lately, like in the fourth and the fifth zone, they pull pretty far to one side.
Yes, and they're probably going to wait to see how to rotate this after the storm closes right here. And they're probably going to move, it moves south, and they're probably going to have to move very far and possibly early or late rotates to get there.
And plus, if you see right now all the shots on their screen, this could be a bad situation since they have to go pretty far south. They do find a car that's low HP, low gas. They're just going to sit in here for a minute just to see where they want to rotate. There is launch pads on these hills,
It does
though.
Have a pop tire, so we're going to see how far they can get with it. But it already has low HP. It's ticking down by the second, already at 200 health. That car can explode and cause significant damage to them if it does explode.
And if you see on their map right now, it's the Zeus medallion that is on the ground at the moment. So there is someone in the lobby that is running around with the Mythic DMR.
It looks like they're going to try to get to this bush and sit in it for some placement points. And they're currently in the bush and looking for players.
Yeah, sitting in this bush, placement points. They're in circle now, too. Early rotate, so they don't have to worry. They could get some of these teams that were behind them while they're coming in and try to get some initial tags on them and hopefully get the elimination.
Yeah. Yeah, they're just going to grind out these placement points and see how many points they can get for qualifying for this tournament.
Yeah, and they're pretty much right now as all Ferris players for Fortnite in the bush.
Obviously.
That's our key spot.
Exactly. And I do see clingers in Dark's inventory. And those can play pretty crucial in endgame.
Oh yeah, I mean when you're stuck up on a team, and you're just trying to disengage, but they're just putting pressure on you. You throw some of those clingers, and it's like mice almost. They just start scattering.
Exactly, and it looks like Droid still has four bunkers and impulses to his name. So we're going to see how they play those towards the end of the game.
And, you know, we're just getting these little funny face things with Fortnite. Currently, they do know there's multiple teams in the open shooting at each other. They do see this a lot of loot. That Fullberry Fist could be a crucial thing for them to pick up if they do get a chance to go over there.
Yes, but is it worth almost getting attacked by a team?
I mean, one of those bunkers from droids could be a crucial thing to grab one of those Fullberry Fists.
True, true. You could use it as cover and possibly even get more advantages. But is it a risk you want to take, really?
And sometimes in the end game, risk is the matter of any major factor to win a game. If you don't take a risk, well, that could be the decider for you to lose it. But the worst thing about being in this area, though, as if you see right now, Mount Olympus is in the area.
Mount Olympus does have height advantage, so they will have to be playing low ground for this circle, and we're going to see how well they play when they don't have the height advantage.
We're currently hoping that this storm pulls more towards the north. Because if it pulls north, we can at least set, it's a lot of open area. So they could probably use these bunkers and try to get some tags. As you see right now, people are airbending right through their bush as this player sees them and then tries to run away.
A couple 68 tags by droids with the thermal DMR against those airbenders. Also, I see up in the mini-map area that the train tunnel is in the zone. There could be players just hiding down in that area, which is a common spot for a lot of people to take cover.
As you see, the circle does pull towards that train area as well. So people could be playing under under the map, just hiding, getting just placements. As you see right now, droids throws down a bunker just to give themselves protection. They're on the edge of it. So they do know most of those teams are south, and they're going to push for pretty much pushing in the same area that they're sitting in, so they could get some easy tags.
Yes, Dark did pick up the Flowberry Fizz over the Airbending Mythic, which is a little surprising to me, because that Airbending Mythic could get you across the map, but if he does play with droids here, then he could manage to move with them and possibly stick together better to get free elims and some more placement.
That's true. I can see exactly what Dark was probably thinking, is that the airbending up close, a lot of people like to target. But using that Fullberry Fizz and Shockwave, you could pretty much get anywhere on the map that you want to go pretty quick.
But they also got to be careful, because if Droids gets knocked, then he has all the bunkers. Dark could be in trouble without any of these bunkers. He has Fizz and Clingers. But he's going to have to play off his natural environment.
Yeah, as we see right now, they're just waiting for these teams to push in. Storm's closing with 30 seconds left. They're spotting this one team that's sitting in a bush. They're going to probably look for this guy to rotate out and probably get a couple picks on him. If not, they're just going to play safe. Wait for that to the end game to get those elims, get those points, and probably win this game out.
Yes, they are already top 14. And that we're starting to get to moving zones, and they are taking an engagement with this team rotating into zone as they shockwave away. Droids does get a knock with a marksman rifle, so we're gonna see if you get the finish.
And here we see that storm pull again far west, which is always a horrible thing for most people. But he did get the droids did get that elimination in the storm.
Dark does have Fizz, and Droids has impulses, so they could get across the zone pretty quick if they play it right. And we're just seeing them spot teammates here, and there they go impulsing. Dark is popping some more Fizz, so he could keep on going.
They need to get into this and throw a bunker down and not try to take any of these fights. It'll be a crucial thing if they try to fight people right now.
Okay, Droids took a little bit of damage there. He's healing up right now. Threw a bunker down, already in the zone. A team is engaging him. Droids is taking major damage.
Droids with one knock.
And the other team is firebending, but Dark does manage to finish the last one.
and we'll see if he can get beneath him to reboot or not, or revive or not.
Droid's right now down. Dark trying to just stay alive as much as he can. Going for this revive. No one's really paying attention to them, so he probably could get this off.
But they'd... he has to be aware of his right side, because that's a really open area, and there are people there. So, and there's a person rotating to his left right here. Droids gets knocked again.
50, 94, 110.
Dark gets a lot of damage off. He needs to get out of there or deal some major damage to this team. He gets one knock.
Getting
gets
that
the
third.
Finish. There's five players left.
Dark looking very...
And he gets hit with that DMR that does major damage. But they did get fourth, and they did get a lot of kills. So.
They played way better this last qualifier game. I mean, with top four out of most of their games, this is probably their best game they had today. Yep.
Sadly, White died earlier in the match, but it is what it is.
And as we wrap it up here, I mean, both teams they tried their best. I mean, we'll see if they did qual off of points or if they actually got to the top four in their games. I mean, I'm hoping the best for the Ferris teams.
Exactly. I'm hoping they all qualled. You know, there was a lot of games where they had great points, great placement, and there's some games where they just got unlucky. So
that's true here. It was great casting today for the Ferris Esports for Fortnite. It was glad to have you guys here, and I hope you guys have a wonderful weekend.